wasn't, you know, I think now people think more about international law being something that's real, but, you know, when I was in law school and obviously years before that, you know, it wasn't like contract law where you would go to a book and it's all the law. In New York, where I went to school in New York, it's very much a heavily business law, constitutional law kind of thing. And so, you know, but in general, it was kind of like a fuzzy law. You know, it wasn't, it's all about international customary law. You know, it's what we did, what's the precedent. There wasn't a lot of stuff in books. You look back and you try to figure out where that came from, you know, like that kind of sparks something, which is important. Why I always say, young people, talk to young people, because, you know, you never know what they're going to want to do in life, and you never know what can spark that interest, right? So I think that's where it all came from. So anyway, I decided to do that, and that's what I've done all my life. It's been in international law. And then, you know, after being at the State Department for a while, I decided that I really wanted to do, I was committed to international law, so I went back to school and got my master's in international law. But then I realized at State Department I was doing a lot of policy. It's a lot of policy, even though it's law. So I went back to school to get my PhD in international relations. And so I don't do law now. I'm a policy person. And so that's kind of how, circuitous way how I got to where I am now. Even though I still like law, for those of you who know, law's still good. And I'm the only woman. And, you know, and getting a sense, particularly for women of color, being the only woman and not feeling a support system. And what happens is, then people will leave the field because they don't feel like, you know, I don't see anyone that looks like me, I don't have a support system. And so one of the things I wanted to do was really try to address what was an issue that I felt as an individual, as one person I could try to do, is to establish an organization where the main goal is to, you know, take all these women in the international security field, peace and security, who felt like they were by themselves. And really, if I keep hearing this from people, then they're obviously more than that one person. You know, pull them together, have a support system that will help them feel that they're not by themselves, but will also, they can also want to stay and feel longer. Because when they feel those moments of, you know, just the imposter syndrome, or, you know, unconscious bias, or discrimination that they're not, they don't feel like anyone cares, that they can actually have someone to reach out to. And then they could, you know, go out and talk about it. Go out for a drink with friends and talk about it. Call somebody on the phone and develop this support system. But also I wanted to find a way for people to see that there's women in these fields. I mean, how many times you say, I don't have a woman on a panel because I don't know anyone? That's BS. They just didn't try. You know, but I said, well, let's make it a little easier for people. Let's bring them all together. And then when people need, you know, to show these amazing women who are in these fields that we can help them find them, so that excuse doesn't exist anymore. You know, and so that developed into a lot of other reasons why I established my organization, Women of Color, Grants of Peace and Security, because of that need. And interestingly enough, when I started in 2017, I looked around and I was really surprised that something like this didn't exist in 2017. And it was great because once, and I didn't know for the moment, I said, well, maybe nobody wants to do this. But I went ahead with it, and I was very pleased to see that there was, other people felt this gap, this need to do this. So I've learned a lot of lessons from that, and, you know, in terms of the need to have a support system, and the need to have to know who to reach out to, find ways that you could develop your own professional development. Because sometimes you want to write something, you don't know what publication is going to put it. So I said, let's do our own. I said, you know, a lot of women of color weren't getting published. I said, let's publish our own stuff. So we started publishing our own periodicals. And then suddenly others wanted these women to start writing for them. It's almost like, you know, you have to do it. You have to. In life, sometimes you say, you just got to do it, you know, and see what happens. And so then I started doing a lot of those things. We started something called Organizations of Solidarity, which is an effort to bring organizations together that want to diversify and do more in these spaces. And this followed the George Floyd murder. And all lot of organizations wanted to do something, wanted to feel like, how can I make a difference? And I also heard from a lot of women of color who felt really unhappy when they went to work and there was no one at their jobs who felt comfortable talking to them about their experience and what they were feeling. And so having organizations want to make a change was great. You know, because I thought this is going to help do that. The last thing I'll say, obviously, because I know we need time to ask questions, is, you know, I feel very honored that this administration appointed me in my role, because I'm the first African American to ever, there's been no African American on the Secretary of State, ever, which I found really interesting in 2021, but there was none before. But I commend this administration for my appointment. I commend them for being the first African American woman in this role. I can say we've had women in my position before, which is great. So we had that, you know, which I always thought was amazing for our hard security field to have so many undersecretaries of state for national security. So being the first African American in this role is an honor, as well. But you know, the administration is really trying to make an effort to diversify. I have the honor of being part of a delegation, and I look at Ambassador Hogate, who's here as our ambassador, who's a woman who champions all these issues of gender diversity. It's just wonderful to be part of a delegation that has so many women. And you know, and I, you know, like I said, I don't have a chance to meet all of you, but if numbers say something, I mean, we're overflowing. This to me is a reflection of the women who are here and the men who are here who are also our allies on this issue. So it's very encouraging. And I think we still have a ways to go, but I think all of us here, if we are champions and we are all of your role models, and one thing I always say is you never know who's looking up at you. Never know. You never know the young girl who looks up and says, I want to do that. You know, the way you can impact people just by being who you are and doing what you do. It's amazing. And like I said, they just young people just want to see people who look like them if they're going to stay in the field. I didn't see a lot of people look like me when I got into it. I just wanted to do it. But you know, to stay in it, you know, you know, seeing other people say they can do it, I can do it.
you don't even remember that, because one of the treaties that I was responsible for said that the states ought to have rules and regulations which implement the Early Notification and Assistance Convention, and I said to the lawyers, why can't we ask the states? And you don't ask the states those kinds of things. And so instead, I got her to go and look it up. All I remember, it all got rejected and the work was worthless, but she was very perseverant and she was very good. And I have been watching her just rise up, and I'm so proud of you. Thank you.
Working with the IE. I had no idea all of this would follow. You know, so thank you for being here.
Wonderful. So now we have, unfortunately,
can do. They don't, because if they knew you, they would know you're capable of doing this. So somebody who discounts you and says, and has that attitude, don't know who you are and don't know what you can do, and so wasting your time worrying about it, or wasting your time trying to prove it, and you may never prove it because you don't know why they have that opinion. If they don't like people of color since they were a child, there's nothing you can do. You know, so you just don't worry. You have to get to a point, and you will eventually, if you're not there, you just say, I can't deal with this. It's your problem. You deal with it. That's your burden. I'm not taking it on. I got things to do. So that's how I deal with any kind of bias. And you get to a point, you can spot it as soon as you walk in the room. You know exactly who is like that. You know, and if they think they're hiding it, it don't matter. You can, you know, the way they approach you, the way they shake your hand, at you at a meeting, how they only talk to certain people. I mean, you could spot it, and you know, people may think, "Oh, I'm, you know, I'm not showing it." No, no, people see it. You know, and that also helps you determine how you're going to deal with that person. And you're going to say, "Well, here, I see you like that. Eh, I won't deal with you. I have to deal with these people." You know, that level depends on your own confidence, the type of job, the type of person it is. You know, you have to weigh all of that, and how much you want to deal with that every day. But you also have to recognize how it impacts you and your health and your perception of yourself and of life. And you may, you know, it depends on where you are in life and what you can handle and what you don't want to handle. So it's different for every person. There is no one rule, but you have to always think about yourself and your own happiness. And that stuff can create stress. It can make you mentally, you know, exhausted, physically exhausted, depending on the type of situation. So, you know, some people just can't change. You can try and you make the effort, but then you have to decide for yourself what's best for your own health. And sometimes it means leaving a situation that you, a job you really like, and you know, I mean, life has an interesting way and interesting turns, and you can find yourself back there with a different environment. So you just never know, but you have to take care of yourself.
Do you think, or what is your opinion about bringing more women into this area? What would be the impact of that when it comes to international peace and international security and disarmament and all these aspects? Thank you.
Well, obviously we should, because we need to recognize that these issues affect everyone. I think they're, you know, I know there's a lot of people who see some of these issues and say, oh, they're so big, I can't handle it. I'm just going to deal with the issues that affect me every single day, which is natural. You know, I think we all care about things that are close to home. But I also think there should be more women who see this field and select themselves out. And they say, oh, this is about hard security, it's about science, it's about, you know, whatever it is, and select themselves out for feel like they can't get into it. But I mean, I got into it through law. I didn't get in here through being a scientist. You know, and I stayed with it all of my life. And so, you know, you don't have to, I think helping people understand, helping women understand that there's a role for you here, and you're half of the population, and anything that happens is going to affect you. So, you know, if you're interested, definitely get involved. The impact is a question I get all the time. You know, I know that I go professional in whatever color I wanted and do my job, and, you know, and what was important is what the job I was doing. You know, and, you know, I didn't wear pink hair or anything like that, but, you know, I certainly felt I felt comfortable being who I am. You know, I'm undersecretary, and I wear my headphones. And I heard somebody say to me, a young African-American woman say, I was so inspired when I saw you and you took your photo, your official photo in Grace. You know, and it was a decision that I made. When I went to the first senior staff meeting with Secretary Blinken, Deputy Secretary Libby Sherman, and I made a decision. I'm gonna be who I am. And I haven't had any problems with that. So, you know, it was a conscious decision I made, but, I didn't feel in that situation that I was taking a huge leap with the company I was in. But yeah, I mean, it's so important to be who you are. And I would like to think that that's kind of going away a little bit, that some of you are not feeling in your jobs a real rigidness to be the black suit. I mean, black suits are nice. I have black suits. But not that, you know, nothing against it, because you can have some fancy black suits too. But, you know, that's going away.
Wonderful. Unfortunately, we are over the time. We need to come to the end. Thank you, Her Excellency Ambassador Jenkins, for your kind and encouraging words, especially to the young generation, because They are the ones who will take over our jobs. And as we all know, times are not easy and we live in challenging times. So we need to encourage them to be strong and prepared. And as Amber, my colleague, said, unfortunately she left, she told me last week a very nice quote, and that was, if you see her, you can be her. And I was like, wow, and it fits here. We see you, thank you for your time. We want to be like you, different, but in our way, but you are a big role model to many of us in the room and also at the agency. And also thank you for highlighting the challenging issues that we are struggling with at the moment. But that brings me back to the topic of this event, and that was the equality in supporting young generation. And, you know, it's part of the UN Sustainable Goals. And here I would like to say that I would like everyone, once we leave this room, to know that we all need to do our part individually and collectively. We need to fight for equality, for justice, for respect. And even though we live in challenging times, it should not be scratched out of our agenda. So please think about it. Thank you very much, all of you, for your time. I would like us all to